Oh, I love to hear the song of creation, the wind and the rhythm of the rain. Oh, the thunder, it speaks of your power. But there's something in the sound of the saints. I've been washed in the roar of the ocean, found peace in the echoes of a cave. And the trees of the fields, they clap their hands. There's something in the sound of the saints, from the lips of those you saved. A redemption song will rise, with a sound so full it cracks the sky. Whoa, whoa. Forever a symphony of praise. Oh, I long to hear the voice of my Savior, and he hears us, the sound of the saints, from the lips of those you saved. A redemption song will rise, with the sound so full it cracks the sky.
Time for you to sing with the sound of the saints. So if you guys would stand with us, we just want to worship together, welcome the Lord, begin our celebration of who he is. And as we do that and we sing these songs, Psalms say that we enter his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. So as we sing these things, I want you to review your week and the things that you know that God has done for you and given you peace. Just give thanks for that, and then we'll usher ourselves into praise.
Are gathered here to see. how great I am. No end and no beginning, you were and are, and evermore you shall be. All my days are in your hands, and all my days are in your hands.
Deserves that. He is holy and righteous. You know, we live in such a beautiful place that sometimes we just need to sing about creation and God's hand in it. This song reminds me of camp. And basically, we're just going to sing, I've decided to follow Jesus. So if you went to camp and you remember that, I'm going to be using that as part of this song. Christ is my reward, and he's all my devotion.
Turning back.
Amen. He He is so worthy to be followed. We've kind of begun this song here. You are worthy, O Lord, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by your will, they were created and they have their being. Fascinated by your beauty, captivated by your love, intoxicated by your glory, forever will not be enough. Saturated in your mercy, I'm liberated by your grace. Consecrated to be holy, forever I will seek your face, for you are worthy. Singing with you guys this morning, so please be seated. Thanks. Amen.
Well, welcome to our Sunday morning service. For those of you that are joining us for the first time or back checking us out, we have a free gift out in the lobby for you. Please stop by and pick that up. And also talk to the folks that are there. Get to know our church a little bit. Got a lot of things going on during the week, a lot of youth programs, a lot of small group studies and stuff like that. And love to see you join in on those. A couple quick announcements to go over. For those of you who are technologically challenged, don't have email or just want a piece of paper in your hand, we do have a limited number of church bulletins out in the lobby, so feel free to pick those up. And we have a church camping trip that's coming up this week. We can do some paddle boarding. Pay no attention to the 800-pound gorilla there. Looks real easy, right? Oh no. So it will be fun, I promise. And the water's warm up there. We should be getting up there around Friday afternoon around 4 o'clock, and we'll go till dark 30 on Saturday. So get out your kayaks, fishing poles, paddle boards, dinghies, bring your yard games, bring your grub. We'll bring the s'mores. And check out the church email this week for a lot more details coming in on that.
So we have in the paid site, we have Campsite 4. Which is a super awesome peninsula site, which is really cool. You can kind of at Worthen. So, you can just pull your boats up, and there's some other tent room, but it's a super cool site. So we did get that one. If you're not camping, we hope that you just come up for the day, so you can park over in the kind of the boat ramp area or the picnic area, and then just cruise up to Camp 4 is kind of our central location. And we'll just be hanging out and enjoying the day. So on Friday evening or Saturday. So anyway, think about it. And if you're camping in the paid sites or the dispersed sites, Camp 4 at Worthen Meadows is going to be your central location. So we're hoping to get 3-2, but we'll see about that today. But we've got Camp 4 for sure.
Thanks, Chad. We also have a spaghetti dinner that is starting in a couple weeks, August 26th. We'll start at 5:45. So if you'd like to attend, we have a sign-up deal online. I think we've already got like 33-some-odd people already registered. That's really cool. And you can also sign up over at the Connections table out in the foyer. The cost is $5 per person or $10 per family. So Jason said there was going to be some gluten-free stuff there too, right? So the men will be putting on the dinners. And if you'd like to help out, just talk to Marty or Amy. Let them know that you are interested in helping. Rich is really excited to be joining in and helping out every week and just getting shoulder to shoulder with everyone. So a little update on Rich and the family. I think this week they're going into temporary housing. And then also means that their stuff is going to be entering a crate and be making its way here. They've got airline tickets already reserved, so we're making advancements. This is becoming a thing now. Woo-hoo. I know we've been, yes. I know it's been a little up and down, all that kind of stuff, but we're finally starting to kind of see some finality come here. So, and just a shout out to Rich. Again, I've mentioned that before, that he's just invested so much, but I know he's going to be picking this up probably in about 6 hours. But Rich, again, thank you so much for the time that you've invested so far in our church and our people. We are so excited for you to come, for you and Don and the kids to come. It's just, we're just overwhelmed with excitement for you to get here. So, amen, yes. Over the last year, our church has experienced a lot of things. We lost a pastor that had been with us for 10 years. We made changes to our constitution. We brought in an interim pastor. We changed the time frame of our operating year. Found a new pastor, lost a new pastor, found a new pastor again. Shut down church, learned to Zoom, and felt the heightened pressures of the world around us as it affects us, even in our small little rural community, which I thought you couldn't touch us here, but it makes its way. But even in all that, I'm just amazed and encouraged how this church particularly has just rallied around each other, supporting one another. I saw how welcomed we were, with arms just wide open, with an 86-year-old man and his wife as they joined our family for a brief period of time, but what a blessing that was. I saw a pastor search team just work tirelessly, just praying and just working towards finding us a new pastor. And then I saw a church just unify in prayer, which that was incredible, just awesome to see. Because as soon as we started doing that, immediately things just happen. And it just reinforces the reason why we pray. We saw us go through, you know, some pretty sensitive documents that usually just don't get touched when you talk about constitutions and things like that. I saw our church kind of struggle a little bit with some just budgetary items. And currently, I'm just witnessing our church be blessed with how wonderful our giving has been. And it just truly shows what our trust in God, even with all that's going on around us, how so valuable and so vital that is. I'm really excited for the Douglases to come and experience how just wonderful this church is. And I'm even more excited to see what this church is going to become when he gets here. God's limitless, and because of that, so are his people, so is his church. So personally, I think I'm speaking for a lot of other folks when I say that on behalf of my family, thank you for just being such a wonderful group of folks, being such a wonderful church for me and my family to attend. So this morning I want to open up to Ephesians 4, 1 through 6. It writes, "As a prisoner for the Lord, then I urge you to live life worthy of the calling you have received, being completely humble and gentle, be patient, bearing with one another in love, making every effort to keep the unity of the Spirit through the bond of peace. There is one body, one Spirit, just as you were called to one hope when you were called, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is all over and through all in all." Would you please pray with me? Father, thank you so much for this blessed day. Thank you for this place that we can freely worship in. Thank you for this body of believers. Lord, we need you. Some days it feels like the world is against us, against you. There are troubles at every turn. As we study your word and 1 Peter, we're also grateful and that even in our struggles, you're there for us. We pray for challenges and chances to grow, which is that is the time that we rely on you and only you. We pray for your continued blessings here in this church, and we seek wisdom to glorify your name in many ways. We pray that as Rich and Donna and the kids physically join our family, that the things we will accomplish beyond anything that we can even imagine. Lord, we ask that you prepare our hearts and minds for today's message as you've equipped our wonderful brother Bob to do. Father, we are limited by your grace. We're liberated by your grace. Father, we are saturated by your mercy. Forever with you, it's not enough. Forever we seek your face, for you are worthy. Worthy of our praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Would you guys stand again? We're just going to, before we go to our sermon, sing the song of surrender.
I surrender all.
thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all.
Amen. Lord, we just give you praise. We thank you for moving in our lives and moving in our service already this morning. Lord, as you unfold your word in just a minute, let our hearts hear it. We give you praise and honor and glory, and we surrender all to you and try not to get in front. In Christ's name I pray, amen. Please be seated.
Noah, am I on yet? Okay. How many of you have ever seen or watched, there was an old show on TV a while back called The A-Team? Okay. What was the main thing that got the head leader, I forget what his name was, Hannibal? I can't remember what his name. But what did he always say at the end of the show? I love it when a plan comes together. Just listening to the songs today tie in exactly with what we're going to do. Now, that can only be a God thing, how he puts the songs to relate to what we're doing. Okay? Now, I want you to watch what I'm doing. And if you have a long sleeve shirt on, I encourage you to do the same. Okay, why am I doing this? It's not because it's hot in here. Because we're about to get elbows deep into what we're looking at. Okay? So, we're going to start this morning. If you need a cup of coffee, go get a cup of coffee, because I'll try to be in within our time frame, but I'm not promising anything. The more I started looking at this, the deeper and deeper, and rabbit trail after rabbit trail, it was like incredible how much material is in this passage. We're looking at 1 Peter chapter 1, verses 13 through the end of the chapter, and then chapter 2, verses 1 through 10. Now, in the olden days when the manuscripts were first written, there was not chapter divisions, verse divisions. That was put in later on. So that's why I'm going through, because this thought pattern continues on into chapter 2. I don't know why they put a chapter 2 right in the middle of a thought process, but that's how it happened. So here we go. 1 Peter, it is so rich, so full of content, so relevant for today, and so full of instructions and answers on how we need to be living today. Yes, it was written a long time ago. Yes, it was written historically during a terrible time of history. Christians were being persecuted. They were being persecuted for meeting together, persecuted for sharing their faith, and persecuted for believing in and living for Jesus. Now, last week, we started 1 Peter with Aaron, and he covered the first 12 verses, but we're going to just do a quick little recap on what that was about. It was written by Peter, probably in Rome, probably around AD 60-ish, to a group of churches that covered a large area that is now known as Turkey. And Peter probably didn't know these Christians. He hadn't visited these churches, neither had Paul at this point. And as a matter of fact, we don't know a whole lot about the recipients of this letter other than they were Gentiles. And how do we know they're Gentiles? Remember a long time ago I did a thing called proof and evidence? Okay, we're going to pull some proof and evidence out of this passage here that shows that he wasn't talking to the Jews, he was talking to the Gentiles. Okay, the churches were struggling to stay firm in their faith under the emperor of Nero. Now, we all know the stories of Nero. And knowing this time frame, we can understand that the recipients of this letter were living during tough times, just like we are living in tough times today. And Peter began writing to them, reminding them that they were chosen by God, they were set apart by him through the blood of Jesus, and that their identity was to be found in their calling. And even though the practical result of that is that they were living as strangers in this world. And this is a truth for us today, that we're in this world, but not of it. Hope you're following me here. And so we must do our best to work out what it means to live as Christians today, in spite of what all is going on in our world today. So that's pretty much a summary of the first 12 verses. And the rest of Peter's letter is about helping us to work out the principles by which we are to live today. Now, Leslie has told me that she's been watching me teach and stuff for 40 years and so, and she says I've developed a couple of habits. So I'm going to try real hard not to do them. One of them is this. And the other one is rubbing my non-existent hair. So I will try to be conscious about not doing this and not doing this. So let's jump right in. We got your... Did I do it again? Okay, so Peter jumps right in with verse 13. And he jumps right in with the nuts and bolts of what he wants them and us to know. It says in verse 13, therefore, prepare your minds for action. What was the first word? Therefore. Our small group on Sunday nights, we've gotten into this habit of saying, anytime a passage begins with therefore, we always ask, what's the therefore? Therefore. It's a connecting word, and it connects one thought to another. It's saying that what I said before, I'm fixing to relate to that by saying something else. So therefore, listen to what I'm saying. So it's the beginning of a thought. In this case, he says, therefore, prepare your minds. How? There's a real sense of urgency here in that he's saying that we need to live out our faith. Now, it's a real sense of urgency in the way Peter says this. Prepare it for action. Now, it's not that we prepare our mind for something that may happen in the future, sometime in the future, but right now. Prepare your minds right now. We are to be prepared to act now, not someday, not eventually, not when we feel called to do something, not at some future point in our lives. Whether you profess to be a 9-year-old believer or a 79-year-old believer, Peter is telling us that we are to prepare our minds now. So, the question is, how do you prepare your minds? Peter tells us it begins with our minds. Is this challenge for us to gain more knowledge? More knowledge about what? More knowledge about Christian beliefs, okay? Well, to find this answer, look at the rest of the verse. It says, discipline yourself. Set all your hope on the grace that Jesus Christ will bring you when he is revealed. Yes, there is a need to gain knowledge, but we also need to begin to prepare our mind through prayer. What does prayer do? Well, prayer requires a discipline. You have to set the time aside for it. We have to spend our time with God, and through that, we increase our hope and our understanding of the grace that we have through Christ revealing himself to us. Now, Peter is showing us here how to equip ourselves and prepare. I didn't do it. I had an itch. Peter is showing us how to equip ourselves and prepare for our earthly struggles and trials. Now, is there anybody here that can't use these tools? No. Everybody here needs these tools on how to equip ourselves with the struggles and the trials. And Peter is saying that that we can cope and we can survive these troubles and these trials and struggles if we spend time praying and meditating on the future hope that is to be revealed. If you notice that, a quote from that verse there, a future hope to be revealed. What is that future hope? We'll get to that in a minute. Now, if you listen to it, it says, the future hope that is to be revealed. This sounds like we're waiting on something. We're waiting for that day. What is that day? It's the day when Christ comes again. So how do we wait? Verse 14 tells us how. It says, like obedient children, do not be conformed to the desires that you formerly had in ignorance. Okay. So we are to wait like obedient children, but remember I said we're going to pull out some proof and evidence about his audience, his Gentiles? Okay, here's one of them right here. The key here that tells us it's a Gentile audience, he uses the word ignorance. Okay, I'm waiting. Why is that important? Well, he was most likely not referring to Jews because they were not ignorant in the word. They had the knowledge of it. So he's obviously not talking to the Jews here. He's talking to the Gentiles because they were ignorant of the law and of the word. And secondly, the word he uses for desires. Okay, I have to be real careful about how I did it, didn't I? I have to be real careful about how I proceed here. Desires sometimes is used the word passions. Now, the word that Peter is using here for desires is a neutral word. It's not a negative word. It's not a positive word. It's a neutral word. So basically, I think what Peter is saying that our desires are not necessarily bad. Historically, churches have taught for centuries that desires are bad, and we should try to get rid of our desires, get them under control. And I don't think that's what Peter's saying right here, but we do need to look at what our desires are. How are we processing what our desires are, and are our desires in line with Scripture? And thirdly, in this same verse, Peter calls us to obedience. And this word does not have to do with our moral or ethical behavior as much as the idea that obedience is about us accepting the gospel and believing in Christ. That is our spiritual obedience. And finally, in this verse, I know I'm spending a lot of time on this verse because there's so much there. He begins, like obedient children. Now, this is a positional statement. Big words. He puts his audience, including us, in the right position. The audience of his teaching should understand how he is calling us to approach these principles. We have a father, and we are called to be like obedient children. Obedient children honor their father and their mother. We are to honor that authority and the instruction given by this authority. In this case, our authority is who? God. And we are to approach his instruction with an attitude of obedience. Now, this is a position that we shouldn't take for granted. Can I stop right here and ask ourselves, is this our attitude? Are we having an attitude of obedience? Are we positionally putting ourselves under God's authority? And are we ready to obey what he is calling us to do? Something to think about. Now, this verse alone is chock-a-block full of theology, and that we could spend a whole sermon on the theology just behind that verse, but we're going to move on. In verse 15, it says, "But just as he who called you is holy, so be holy in all you do." Bam. Let's just jump into the deep end of the pool here. Is he telling us to become holy? No, he's saying be holy. How can we be holy? Well, you know what? We already are. Let me find my place here and not get lost. I don't want to get ahead of myself. So Peter is calling you and I to be holy, not to become holy, but to be holy. What does this imply? The truth is, you and I, as believers, are already holy. We're not becoming holy. We are holy, so be holy. So often in Christianity, we tend to soften who we are in Christ. But here's one place that we are not striving to be something because we already are. We are holy. And our status is not one of becoming holy based on our behavior, because then we will be able to become holy through our behavior. But we are holy. Now, I've repeated that a lot. We are holy. Be holy. Because that's important. It's mentioned in scriptures, and so that is our status, period. How can we be holy then? So what does that mean? As a believer, through Christ, we are holy because he is holy. And I like to think that our holiness is deposited into us, deposited through our faith in Christ. Living it, though, is our responsibility. So we learn and understand what this means by studying Christ, how he lived, how he loved, and his obedience to the Father. So God's holiness is linked to the idea that he is set apart by his holiness. So our holiness is linked to the same idea that by living obediently as God calls us to live, we are by nature set apart. Now, Peter goes on in the next verse and says, if you call, this is interesting. If you call on a father who judges all people impartially, live in reverent fear in your time of exile. Now, I have two thoughts here about on God's nature. First thought, what God is in himself and in relation to the whole world. And then secondly, who he is in relation to us as believers. There seems to be a little bit of tension in this verse. Father versus judge. Okay? As the creator God of the universe, he has the right to judge all people. He can be impartial because he's holy. In other words, he cannot be holy and partial. His nature being holy naturally implies that he must judge without partiality. Yeah, this thought, it's not a popular thought among some people. They only want the loving, caring side of God without the judgmental side of God. But we all know that that time is coming, which he emphatically, because he's perfect and holy, our sins must be judged. But here in this verse, we also see the same God being called our Father. This is now moving towards a more personal, intimate relationship. Peter is calling us to live in reverent fear. This can only be accomplished if you see God as the Father and the judge in respect to who God is and who we are. And this fear is a respectful fear. It's not a terror fear. It's a fear of respect. Kind of like some people, when they see a police car going down the road, they'll automatically slow down. Just out of respect for the law, right? Or your teacher at school. It's a respectful fear. You fear that teacher out of respect, not because she's going to whoop you or something. So when we fully grasp who God is, we should automatically have reverential fear out of respect for who he is. Now, once again, in verse 18, we have another clue, proof and evidence, as to the audience being Gentiles. Peter refers to the futile ways inherited from your ancestors. Okay? This wouldn't have been the way Peter would have addressed his intended audience if they were Jews. But in verse 19, it says, it is only through the blood of Jesus we are saved. Amen. This statement should settle it once and for all of Peter's audience and for today. We are all familiar with the different many religions that have added to the requirements, not just Jesus' blood, but they have to add other things to gain your salvation. Just like Peter's audience was struggling with, the same issues concerning Christ's redeeming blood being the only thing needed to cleanse us. It was happening 2,000 years ago also. They kept trying to add to it, not realizing that it's just the cleansing blood of Jesus that we need for our salvation. Now, as we move on into verse 20, oh, I see everybody's looking down. As we see Jesus says, was destined before the foundation of the world to have a particular role. Okay, what was that particular role? The salvation of the world. And we see that time. Okay, here, I had an aha moment of thinking about stuff. Genesis 1 says, in the beginning, God created the heaven and the earth. What happened? What did God do before he created the heaven and earth? He's always has been and always is and always will be. So was he doing something before he created our heaven and earth? Just food for thought. So I kind of put two and two together, and I kind of had the idea that, okay, what if God has all these time periods of things that he has done before he created our creation, he created something else. And so it's divided up into eras or epochs, and our time frame started when he created us, and our time frame will end at the second coming. Oh, just kind of deep thought. I don't know. Sometimes I get on rabbit trails like that. So Are you full yet? Do you need to roll your sleeves up a little more? Should we stop here? No. There's more. Okay, verses 21 and 22. Peter does a good job in proving Jesus' validation of who Christ was before the foundation of the earth to his resurrection and God giving him all of his glory. And all this was to remind us that our faith is in God. It's through his death, resurrection, and ascension that our faith has become real. And this is the truth Peter wants us to grasp. Now that Peter's laid out the basis of our faith, he calls us to a life of love. Now, this is not a mere tolerance of each other. Oh, I guess I'll have to love you because you're a fellow believer in Christ. No, that's not what it's talking about. It's an absolute acceptance of each other, warts and all. Total acceptance. And now, this kind of love doesn't happen overnight. It takes effort and work. And Peter goes on to say, you have been born again of imperishable, not perishable seeds. Let's look at this word seeds for a minute. It's really interesting because I did a little word search here. It's saying that this love that we're called to have for each other, it grows. Kind of like a seed grows. But he uses a particular word for seed here. He doesn't use the Greek word for the seed itself, but he uses the word spora, which refers to the growing of the seed. I thought that was really pretty cool. Now, this is a seed that God puts in us that is continuously growing within us so that we can increasingly grow in love for one another. It's planted, look at the scripture, through the living and enduring word of God. Now, there's a little word search here I could do on word, because he uses a different word for the word that's not the word of the word. Okay, but we're not going to go into that. So in order for this seed to grow, we must be in the word. And that is what develops and nurtures the love of God to have love for one another. Now, we're at the end of chapter 1, according to the scholars, but the thought continues with the word. What's the word starts off? Somebody say, therefore. Therefore. Okay, there's that word, therefore. What's the therefore? Therefore? Well, it's a connecting thought. He's saying, what I, Peter, just said, now I'm going to base what I'm saying now on what I just said. So, it's a continued thought. So, God has told us that our love for one another will grow as we spend time in his word. Here, Peter's telling us to stop doing some stuff. Malice, deceit, hypocrisy, envy, slander. Get rid of all that stuff. Why? Because if we have all that stuff in us, then we can't really grow. We have to get rid of all that. If they're not part of our life, then Peter gives a picture that I love this picture too, of nurturing and milk. How many of you have grandbabies? Yeah, we all have grand. A lot of us have grandbabies. And babies, period. When you're holding a baby and you're just swaddling him and cuddling him, and then you bring a bottle of milk out, sometimes what that baby does, he'll start squirming and get excited and start smiling and grabbing for that bottle. That's how we should be when we're getting into the Word, because that's our milk. We should get excited. Oh, I'm going to be fed. I'm going to grow. My love is going to grow some more. So we should be that excited. We should be that hungry. We should be that reactive when it comes to being in the Word. And we should know that we need that nutrition, that it feeds us, and that it provides everything that we need. So now Peter is starting to take a change of direction. Up until now, he's been talking to us as individuals. Now he's talking to us collectively as a body of believers. So verse 5, Peter says, we are being built up as a spiritual house for a holy priesthood. Now, we've seen this word priest and priesthood a lot in the Old Testament and the New Testament, and did a little research on the word priest, and it comes from a Latin background. Now, I could be wrong. We have a lot of scholars in here, so call me out if you want to after church. But priest comes from the Latin roots, meaning a bridge builder. If you think back, what was the purpose of the priest in the Old Testament? They were bridged the gap between the people and God. Well, God is calling us to be a priesthood and a spiritual house. So we here at the Free Church of Lander, we're all being built up as a holy priesthood. How can we be a holy priesthood as a church? What's the purpose of a holy priesthood of a church? Our job is to bridge the gap, build a bridge between our community and our church. Our job is to take our God to our community. It's like a bridge. So are we really doing that? Yeah? No? Sometimes? Sometimes not? But that is what we're called to do. We are called to bridge the gap between church and community. So I hope we can do that. Now, finally, in verse 10, Peter concludes with God's inclusion of the Gentiles who were once not his people. And he says in Hosea 1:9, "You are not my people." And he takes that verse and puts it in context here, saying that you are now my people. His point is simply this, that their identity, as well as ours, only happened when they believed in Jesus and found their sense of identity in God. So that's where our identity is. We have to be faithful. We have to be obedient. The three things, main points from this that I want you to take home today is we're called to be set apart from the world, to not conform. We are to love each other deeply and be a bridge builder between our church and our community. There's a lot more in here. I know I didn't give, I mean, I could go off of rabbit trail after rabbit trail after rabbit trail, and there's so much more there. But those are the three main points I wanted to bring you today. Now, keep in mind, at this point in Peter's life, he's probably 50, 60 years old or so. And for the last 30 years, he has been in the business of fishing for men and then discipling them. And he knows all about battling conformity to the world's values. And he knows all about the necessity of pushing into a holy life and the importance of maintaining a healthy hunger and the healthy intake for God's word. Now, Peter is calling us to press into maturity as a Christian disciple. Will you and I be willing to step up to the plate? I think that we should. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for getting us here today. Lord, we thank you for the word through Peter, the instructions that we have for life. Lord, help us to love deeply and love really. Lord, help us to not conform to the world. Lord, help us to be set apart. And Lord, show us to be holy. Lord, we just thank you for the time. Lord, we thank you for your word. And in Jesus' name, amen.
First Peter being about who we are in times of trouble, and so that's kind of where we're going to keep singing this song. We kind of introduced it last week, so I'd like you to stand again. It says, "He will hold me fast." The verses are really neat. "When I fear my faith will fail," I think we've been there. Verse 2, "Though those he saves are his delight." And then we finish up with, "For my life he bled and died." So I know we're learning this song, but as it connects, just start singing it.
Mm-hmm.
fear my faith will fail. Christ will hold me fast. When the tempter would prevail, he will hold me fast. I could never keep my hold through life's fearful path, for my love is often cold. He must hold me fast. He will hold me fast. He will hold me fast. For my Savior loves me so. He will hold me fast. Are his delight. Christ will hold me fast. Precious in his holy sight, he will hold me fast. He'll not let my soul be lost. His promises shall last. Bought by him at such a cost, will hold me back. Justice has been satisfied. He will hold me fast. Yes. Grace with him to endless life. He will hold me fast. Till our faith is turned to sight. When he comes at last.
Christ will hold you fast. Be holy this week. Set your hearts on him. You guys have a great Sunday. We'll see you back this time next week.
Yeah.